Camping Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Join us every Thursday morning
from 6 until at least 7:30.
Check out the Bobby G and Company Show
right here on WSKB 89.5.
Community Radio
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Sometimes you stand, sometimes you turn your back to the wind. There's a world outside every darkened door where blues won't haunt you anymore. Where the brave are free and lovers soar. Come ride with me to the distant shore. We won't hesitate to break down the garden gate. There's not much time left today.
Hey, good morning and welcome to Superintendent Spotlight. It is November 18th. We are officially 1 week away from Thanksgiving. So I love Thanksgiving. I do too. Maybe the food, but the family, all that other thing. So today is the buffet here at Tiger's Pride. I think. Hold on 1 second.
He needs his coat.
There you go. All right, Al, now you're on Superintendent Spotlight too.
No, this is
mine. Oh, there you go. Okay. All right. So this week, I was talking about Thanksgiving. The family's great and the food is great. That's what
exactly.
A little less pressure, not worrying about gifts and shopping.
Yes. Right. Because then you have the holiday, right? Christmas right. or whatever people celebrate, and then that comes forward. So.
And how about the fact that Thanksgiving is coming and the weather today?
Beautiful. Yeah, but beautiful. I just saw, so I hate to so I just, you know, I look ahead at the forecast. And they're saying that a big cool down starting the Sunday after Thanksgiving, and maybe that four-letter word that I can't stand.
We better enjoy it now, you're saying.
Snow. Mm. So let's hope it bypasses us, but it's going to be 65 degrees today, and it's already close to 50 out. So it's perfect. We love this weather. So today our guest, we have Deb Ecker. She is our special ed director, although you have a much longer title.
That's okay. Okay. Better.
And Susan Dargy is the co-host. But before we get into the meat and potatoes, I want to share a few things. So we have a coat drive going on with a partnership with the Greater Westfield Chamber of Commerce. It goes through December 22nd, and we are hopeful that people will give new or slightly used hats, gloves, mittens, scarves, and coats. And, you know, I do say this. I don't know if people realize that 42.7% of our students are economically disadvantaged, and coats are needed and things for winter. And these items can be dropped off at the Greater Westfield Chamber of Commerce at 16 North Elm Street, at Westfield Public Schools in our office at 94 North Elm Street. Also, Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply, and Shortstop Bar and Grill, BHN Carson Center on Mill Street, and, of course, Westfield Barnes Regional Airport, Walmart, and Amelia Park.
And this is always a great drive, and the
last
generosity of
people. Last year we gave out over 500 coats.
Yes, and our office, the downstairs part, is just, it's heartwarming, no pun intended, heartwarming to see those coats piling up in there.
And then we have our Thanksgiving food drive coming up, correct? So, we have now, we're giving out 200 meals, and this is done by the generosity of small and large donations from businesses and, of course, private citizens. And I want to thank Ralph and Sue Figge again for organizing this. And this year they have brought in Eileen and Jimmy Yakum, too. So, with some of the businesses, Raymakers and Sons, Advanced Manufacturing, First and Adams Funeral Home, Elm Electric, Westfield Gas and Electric, R. Levesque Associates, Coldwell Banker, Westfield, Attorney Richard Sullivan III, Lisa Alexak Sullivan at Coldwell Banker, Kathy Wallace McCann at Coldwell Banker, Dr. James McCann at Atlas Chiropractic, Dr. Jane Martone from Dentist, Joanne Papa Dimitri, Realtor from Keller Williams, Witalis and Associates Real Estate, Susan Figge, Ralph Figge, Robert Molta and Real Living Associates, and Dr. Stanley and Joan Conifel. And that's just some. But we thank, really, the support here is terrific. And it's, you know, Chris and I always talk about why it's such a pleasure to be on the, live in Westfield, because it's our work here. The generosity of the community is amazing.
All around. Mm-hmm. Amazing.
So, and again, today I know I said is the buffet at Tiger's Pride. I'm not sure if there are any spots left, but 564-3123 if you want to call. And Deb, while I have you, I just want to chat a little bit about, we have a vaccine clinic coming up, right?
We do, on the 23rd from 3 to 5 at Westfield Middle School. They will be setting up outside. Parents for children's ages 5 and up can go. There's been a link that has been set for them to register, just like you would for any other clinic. Would have already within that link given your consent. You would accompany your child to the clinic, and they would give you the vaccine.
And then we're also, so we've implemented now test and stay.
Mm-hmm. Symptomatic, then
testing. And then symptomatic testing. What's the difference, just for people?
Symptomatic testing is if a student is not feeling well in school and would go to the nurse, just like they would go to the nurse any other time, and they show a combination of symptoms that would give them an indication that it may be COVID. So rather than sending the student home, they would test the student. And if it came out negative, they could remain in school. Of course, you're going to have some kids that come to school, that are in school, that may be symptomatic because they have a high fever. They would go home anyways because they're not feeling well. But if there's any symptom-like, any things that are symptom-like for COVID and they go to the nurse, we can test right there. If it's negative, they don't need to go home.
And then test and stay.
And test and stay are for students who have, say, there's a student in the class that did test. We found out that they did test positive. Other students were deemed a close contact. We would, through contact tracing, know who those students are. They could then take place. They could come to school. They could do test and stay because they were close contact. If they're negative, then they resume activities as normal. They stay in school, and we continue that testing for several days just to make sure.
So they get tested, and then they wait for the rapid results.
Mm-hmm.
They're at school. If they're negative,
they
stay.
If they're negative, they go back to school, and they do their thing.
If they're positive, parent called.
exactly.
So, and now we're going to be starting test and stay in the morning?
Yeah, so one of the things that we're looking into, and we're still working out the details, but we're hoping to get this underway after Thanksgiving, is a drive-through test and stay. So
at City Hall.
At City Hall.
Yeah.
So
before school hours. We can't do it in the parking lots because the buses and the drop-offs would cause some severe complications.
Right.
But
so if your child is deemed close contact and needed to go to school the next day and get tested, you could do it first thing in the morning before school starts. You pull up just like you would at HCC or any other type of testing. They would come out to the car. They would swab. You would park. You wait your 15 minutes. If your child is negative, then the tester will give you a note, a document saying that they're safe to come to school. So we can reach more kids that way. We can do it more quickly. We can do it more efficiently.
It's also, if they're notified after school hours, it's
correct,
a way to
yep,
ensure the student comes to school the next day. I will tell you that, we've almost doubled in cases in the last 3 weeks in the city. And last week, even in our schools, we were up to 34 or 36 cases. So there's an uptick coming.
Yes.
And it's unfortunate, but it is winter too, so more people are indoors, right? And that's one of the things that comes with that. And in the city, there were 99 cases last week. There were over 100 this week. So it's going up. There's always talk about this holiday bump that would be coming. And, you know, one of the things I try to just get out there is that we don't have the option to pivot to remote this year. It's not an option. And therefore, if we have to close the school, those days have to be made up. And of course, with the prediction of a snowy winter, which I don't love to hear, we have to monitor this very closely and make good decisions, even though they may not be popular.
Right. Because when you say no remote option, I think people think back to prior to the pandemic and remote, there was the blizzard bag option.
None of that
for
exists.
Snow days. All of that is off the table now.
Right.
So
we have to be in person
days
for 180 days. And, so if we had to close the school for a week, for example, which would be very unfortunate, those 5 days would have to be made up either at the end of the calendar year. Now, you throw in 5 snow days that happen because of snow, too, and we're talking a bit of a mess. So,
and that's one of the reasons that we've been trying to, that we've partnered with CIC Health and Department of Ed to try to get this testing done. I mean, it's just another way that we wanted to try to be able to keep kids in school.
Right.
Because that's what's really important.
It is. All right. There's enough gloom and doom for the day. All righty. Let's get something positive here.
Yeah.
Well, so let's talk special education, and we've had challenges this year, for sure.
We have had challenges, for sure.
And a lot of that has to do with staffing.
It has. So just like every other company, district,
everywhere,
employer.
There's a help wanted sign everywhere.
We are still recruiting and trying to hire staff. We've had some we've been trying to be as transparent as we can in the school system and through the SPED department as well. We've had some turnover in staff. We've had some vacancies in staff. We're continually trying to hire. We put in place in the beginning of the school year, which I think has really been helpful and I think is a positive positive move, that we've, because of the social, emotional, and behavioral needs of our students, we've added behaviorists, and we have 2 BCBAs, which are board-certified behavior analysts.
Deb's got this down with the acronyms. She's got this down. Right.
To help out with the behavior, any behavioral or social, emotional concerns, just as Susan has hired a supervisor of social, emotional learning. So we're really trying to develop protocols and practices to help address those situations. We still need staff, and we problem solve every day to make sure our kids are covered and that they're being instructed and that services are being delivered. I cannot thank special ed teachers, paraprofessionals, related service providers enough and all the hard work that they've been doing.
Absolutely. We have guests, right? And I want to bring them on the
Absolutely.
Show. So who do we have, Pete? He's got to get them in. So,
okay.
I know our special education supervisors are joining us today, and Jamie O'Neill, he is our another long title.
Lead Manager of Autism and Behavioral Social Emotional Services.
Absolutely. We have Carrie Chapterlane Cox. She is our supervisor for special education grades 5 through 8.
Yep.
And then we have Darlene Fernandez here today, who is, I think, Darlene, your first time on my radio show, so I'm happy to have you. Darlene and I worked together here when I was principal here, and Darlene is the supervisor for Westfield Tech Academy and Westfield High School. Good morning to all three of you.
Good morning, everyone.
Thank you. I think Carrie's the only one that's been on the show before, and Deb, I think. I don't. Jamie's new this year too. So, you started to talk about counseling and behaviors, and I think that it's something we need to talk about because we have seen a significant, I'm not sure what the word to use here, but a significant challenges this year. And it certainly resulted in the year and a half of the COVID, you know, disruption from being in school. But what are we seeing? And I think, there's certainly concerns, and we are doing our best to try to meet the needs of our students with their additional counselors, but there's still more going on, right?
Yes, and I think some of it, like you said, Stefan, is key is that we have, particularly at the elementary level, we have some students who, because of COVID and because of remote learning, we've had students that haven't set foot into a school.
This is our first time.
Like maybe a kindergarten student, they may be a first grade student.
Right.
And some of our older students, even at the middle and high school level, and actually I can ask the supervisors, they can address this better than I, because they're on the ground. They're right. But they, those routines, those procedures, that social, just what do you do when you're in school with a group of people? You know, they haven't been practicing that because of the pandemic. So it's almost like we have to kind of start fresh again.
Sure.
And just
we need to reset. We need to reset our expectations for tier one.
Yes.
And put supports in place for the social, emotional, the academic, those related services,
right.
Occupational therapy.
You know, what's interesting too is
language.
If you look at our society, there's a bit of turmoil right now too, and people are frustrated, and our schools are microcosms of our society. I mean, that's what they are. They're little microcosms. But does anyone want to jump in about what we're working with this year in terms of how we're trying to help our students? Okay, Jamie, go ahead.
Yeah, so I mean, I think that you guys have talked a lot about the current issues, right? So we have staffing issues. We have some of these major issues related to coming back from the pandemic, and Deb nailed it. I mean, we're seeing cases that we have kids that haven't been in school for a couple of years that are transitioning back and trying to figure out what to do in a school setting. I think some of the protocols that we're looking, like Susan talked about in relation to resetting the PBIS model, looking at tiered interventions, increasing the supports of the behavioral staff, also increasing the professionalism and expertise in regards to bringing in board certified behavior analysts. So I think those components are, we're building those pieces and we're working as a team to try to build better programming and reset some of those programming. So it will be a challenge, but we'll see it through and we'll get there.
Agreed. We will get there. It is challenging, but obviously our efforts are very important, right? Carrie, Darlene, anything you want to add to that?
Well, at the high school level, students are finally getting into the swing of things.
Right.
And I do have to say kudos to the staff, though, because they are stepping in above and beyond, providing all those successful experiences for our students. So it's been going well. It's not perfect yet, but we're getting there.
Nice. Carrie? What are you seeing at the intermediate and middle school?
The same thing. I think September and October were a tough, big transition for everyone coming in. And I think right now it's starting to settle down. But we've at WIS and at the middle school, they both hired an extra adjustment counselor. So
right.
I think that's really helpful right now too. And now that we have our both behaviorists on board at both schools, I think we can see more improvement.
Right. You know, the staff, I want to go back to the staffing challenges, because I think we just recently became fully staffed with the additional school adjustment counselors that we added. And it's been difficult. We added 8 counselors
this year. Yes, I think one is still being interviewed.
Oh.
There's one split between 2 elementary schools.
That's still being interviewed.
Still in
so we did add counselors in anticipation that this year was going to be a little more difficult. But then you couple the staffing challenges that we've had, so we haven't had the bodies that we need.
Right.
To have a full, a full intervention model.
Right.
All right, we're going to take our first break. And again, all the songs that will be played today are from one particular year. And at the end of the show, you get to guess. All right, Pete, you ready? Perfect. Here we go.
Okay, I really get to...
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by Westfield Bank. For more than 160 years, Westfield Bank has been an important community presence and commercial leader in the Pioneer Valley. With convenient full banking services in Westfield, West Springfield, East Longmeadow, Agawam, Feeding Hills, Springfield, Southwick, as well as Enfield and Granby, Connecticut, visit us on the web at westfieldbank.org.
I'm Mark Auerbach. Join me every Friday at 8 a.m. for Arts Beat, where you'll meet interesting actors, directors, designers, and musicians here in Western New England.
Community Radio
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
And are we back? We are. Welcome back to Superintendent Spotlight. Okay, he changed the order, though, of the boxes to confuse us. All right, so that was Every Breath You Take by The Police. And my only clue to that is that I had that 8-track, for those of you that remember what those were.
No, actually, they changed the order of the boxes by somebody shut off their screen during the break
on
Zoom, and then Zoom shuffles them, and they just pop up.
Interesting. I didn't know that.
So the rules are if you can't look them up, you can't participate right now.
You have to try to guess, but my clue is the 8-track.
Okay.
You remember the 8-track?
I'm going early. I'm going 84 so far.
Okay, I'm going 82 on this one.
What I hated about the 8-tracks is sometimes you had, like, it would go to the next thing, like, in the middle of a song.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it would get the tone, yeah.
Yeah, it was terrible.
We had the same thing in the radio industry. It was called the cart.
It was like an 8-track?
It was exactly the same technology as an 8-track, and it was an endless loop that stopped on a tone.
Ugh. Mm. Terrible.
Yeah.
All right, we are back with our guests. We have Carrie Chapterlane Cox, our special education supervisor, grades 5 through 8. We have Jamie O'Neill, who is our lead manager of autism
and behavioral services.
Thank you. I will learn that at some point. And we have Darlene Fernandez, our supervisor, grades 9 through 12. So before the break, we were talking about staffing and programming and some of the challenges that are happening in our schools. I'm encouraged to hear that things are improving, so thank you for sharing that. And we know that, but it is November, and I think it takes time, right? I mean, that's the bottom line, is it's going to take time. So what else do we want to talk about? Anything else we want to talk about with that?
I think the other thing in my communications with families and with the evaluation team leaders and with the supervisors, who I could not do this job without them, they're amazing, is IEP meetings. They can be either virtual or in person. So
that wasn't happening before the pandemic,
no,
right?
No, the meetings were all virtual, but since we've come back to in-person learning, one of the things that the Department of Ed is encouraging, and we feel that it's best practice, is to give the parents a choice. Many parents still like to have virtual IEP meetings because they can log on during their lunch break. They may have a transportation issue. They may have young children at home. But we certainly don't want to discourage in-person meetings.
We don't. But I think it probably improves the ability to have meetings on a timely manner.
It sure does.
And space-wise.
Space-wise, too, right?
We're using that same protocol for 504 meetings as well.
Susan is our 504 coordinator for the district. So, and I think... I think it's a convenience factor, right, for parents?
Absolutely.
So that is very helpful. Darlene, at Westfield High School, I mean, when you see it, you were saying that things are improving. You know, I know that Westfield High School still needs some staff. How are we being creative with that to try to make sure that we are covering what we need?
So a lot of our issues for staff is with our one-to-ones, and because we need to be in compliance with their IEPs, staff that are in our rooms, especially our DLP programs, they're helping out by doing two students instead of one student. We have been on school springs constantly checking to see if we have any new applicants, but it's really been dry.
We post on Indeed too. We post on other places, so it's not just School Spring. And I look to see for applicants too, and I actually get excited when I see one new, just one. I know. It is.
But now we're in a situation where one of our special ed teachers at the high school just put in her letter of resignation. So I thought I was complete with hiring teachers. And now I need it.
So now we're back there. So I know that position has been posted. So if any listener is interested in working for us, please go to schoolspring.com, type in Westfield Public Schools, and all the jobs that we have open will come up. So
I also wanted to mention that this is not just, as I'd said before, it's not just Westfield. I communicate regularly with the special ed directors throughout the Western Mass and
It's everywhere.
They're all struggling. We're actually in better shape than some.
Right. Well, you know what it is, too, is when you have a shortage in the labor market, and what happens, of course, is that other districts are stealing from other districts. I mean, that's the name of the game. I'm not going to say that we haven't done that. You know, if they apply and they're interested, then we'd like to have them work for us, right? Carrie, I mean, at the middle and intermediate school, are they fully staffed yet or close?
We are close. We just got a new student in, so we need another one-to-one at WIS, and then we're still looking for a para at the middle school. But other than that, I think we're fully staffed.
Pretty close.
That's good.
Very good. So, Jamie, one of the programs that we obviously are looking to expand this year, or in the process of that, of course, then that we're having our own staffing challenges, is our ASD program, which is our students with autism. Can you talk a little bit about the program and, you know, what are we trying to do and how far have we come?
Well, there's definitely been challenges with staff turnover. What we're trying to do with the program is really develop a leveled program in regards to some of the diagnostic levels. So level one, level two, and level three autism. Really looking at grouping the individuals together based on the ability levels in that and diagnostic levels. We've hired, like you had said, we were kind of pulling from other districts. So I myself been going out there recruiting with people that I've worked with in the past. So we've hired a new teacher. She's got 16 years experience, master's degree in working in ABA classrooms. We've lost a couple different teachers.
What's ABA stand for, Jamie? ABA?
ABA is Applied Behavior Analysis.
Okay.
That's the best practice for students with autism.
Okay.
It's endorsed by the Surgeon General. That's one of the great things that we're doing is increasing some of the expertise with board certified behavior analysts. So it's a program that's getting developed, and we're definitely, it's a work in progress. We're facing those challenges, but we've got some contracts with a company called Futures that is providing registered behavior technicians. So the increase in the, you know, direct support there is a 40-hour training in applied behavior analysis. Then they have to pass a competency assessment as well as an online assessment as well, so they can pass their certification. So it's getting there. Again, we have our challenges, but we're going there.
So, but it's not just us, Jamie, right? I mean, there even the private schools that work with students with autism are having the same staffing challenges, correct?
Absolutely. You know, we've also potentially hired a couple other people from some of the private schools that are new behaviorists to our district. Some of them have great experience, and two of them are actually in programs to become board certified behavior analysts. So you're right, it's everywhere. A lot of the different private schools are having difficulties with their own staffing. So we're all in it together.
It's interesting though, you know, I was as I was watching the news, which I watch less and less of these days because it's so negative, but just that last month, 4 million people resigned from their jobs in this country, and they're calling it the Great Resignation. And I think because people are you know, some workplaces are challenging right now with the COVID, the pandemic, and the effects of that.
Right. Was the statistic for education 1/3 of our teachers either retired or resigned?
Yes. Over the last 2 years in the
country. So we're feeling the impact.
Well, there was already a teacher shortage before the pandemic. And I think, you know, you saw that in special education and you saw that in math and science for sure, correct?
Absolutely.
Now it's pretty widespread. It doesn't necessarily matter. I remember when I got into teaching, social studies teachers were a dime a dozen. You know, that was what the field that I went into, and I was fortunate to get a position. But now, I mean, school districts, we're hurting. We're hurting for staff.
We sure are.
And what is more discouraging is even the pipeline of students coming through the college and university system is declining. So there's, I mean, you know, there are people, you know, in the next 5 to 10 years, of course, we would say right now, that are projecting a serious teacher shortage.
Absolutely.
In this country.
And administrator shortage, because that number of teachers that are going into administration from teaching has
also declined too, right? It used to be, and even for superintendents, you'd have a superintendent posting, there'd be 50 applicants. Now you're lucky if you get 10 to 15, and assistant principals similarly, the amount of applicants has been reduced really in half. And in special education, you're lucky if you get 3 applicants for a position.
Very lucky.
Very lucky to get 3. All right, Pete, are you with us? All right, we're going to take our next break to play another song. That first song, like I said, was The Police, Every Breath You Take. Here's song number two.
Support for Community Radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield.
Listen to me, Michael Buster McMahon, Mondays 8 to 10 a.m. to learn the stories behind your favorite songs. Or don't. I'm not the boss of you.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
And welcome back to Superintendent Spotlight. And we are here broadcasting live from Studio 120 here at Westfield Technical Academy. And so that song was Africa by Toto. So I want to clarify that these songs are all in the Billboard Top 100 in this year that you will eventually guess. So
actually, they're top 25.
They actually are in the top 25. You're right. I was.
I'm wavering between 2 years. I knew they're probably all in the top 25 because yeah. I've done these countdowns. These are year-end countdowns I've done.
I really like today's music selection.
So I'm thinking now it's early on when we started doing this community radio, so it's either 83 or 84.
And I was moving. I was fluctuating to think about 83. I was originally 80. Saying 82, but I think I'm going to move to 83.
Okay.
We'll probably do the New Year's countdown again if you want to stop in and say hello.
That's really fun. I like that.
Yeah.
I will tell you this. I did not have the 8-track for Toto, but I did have the 8-track.
I had the cassette for that.
You did the cassette.
So and CD.
So my first cassette was Michael Jackson Thriller. No, I'm just telling you this.
That was my first album.
That was your first album that you bought?
Mm-hmm.
And
probably is a CD.
But, Pete, we were talking offline because at my house when I was growing up, we had that cabinet. Do you know what I'm talking about?
The cabinet. Yeah, the full radio cabinet. Yep.
It had the 8-track player, a radio, and a turntable built in on the right side.
Usually sold by Reader's Digest.
We called it the hi-fi.
The hi-fi.
The hi-fi. Hi-fi.
And it was like that wooden cabinet, and it had a lid, and you lifted it up, and that's how you played music in our house. And I can't believe I remember that with so much detail, actually. That's a little weird. And you were saying that you were showing
my daughter an album. She wanted to listen to some reggae, so I pulled out a Bob Marley album and opened up the turntable and put it on, and she looked like she had never seen it in her life, like she was looking at a alien or something.
Hey,
she was
vinyl's
amazed.
Making a comeback.
Vinyl is making a comeback, actually.
You know what the hardest part now is?
What?
All the machines that they used to make to press the vinyl, they've destroyed them all, and they're hard to find them.
There's nothing, the sound of a vinyl is very unique.
Well, especially if you've overplayed it and had a long time and a little scratchiness.
Yes.
and it skipped.
Our guests look nonplussed by all this music.
I know, I'm sorry. Well, you can't see Jamie's expression because he has his mask on, which is a good thing if he's in
smart man.
Yes, he is. All right. So again, and we have Carrie Chapterlane Cox, our special education supervisor, grades 5 to 8. Darlene Fernandez, our special education supervisor, 9 to 12. We have Deb Ecker, our special education director, and we have Jamie O'Neill, our lead. I'm still not going to get it, but our lead manager for autism and behavioral services. There we go.
Hey, there you go. You got it.
Closer than I've done it, because I always wonder who has the longest title. Is it Jamie or is it Lauren Figge Cadigan with the science supervisor of science, technology, and engineering?
Right, and now Donna Mendoza with supervisor of counselors and social emotional learning.
That's
is
a pretty
long
one too. It's hard to put that on the card.
I remember Jamie's in charge of BS. That's how I remember.
They're behavioral services.
Yes.
Very good one. Good
there
one.
You go.
All those acronyms are very helpful.
They really are. So, okay. Are there any updates that you want to offer? What do we have to look forward to? We're in November, and what do we anticipate the rest of our school year looking like for special education? I mean, once we get past these challenges, and we will. As you said, Jamie, we're working together, right? So, how do we, what are we hoping the outcomes will be moving forward?
Well, one of the things that we've done is we continue to do is work closely with CPAC.
Special Education Parent Advisory Council.
Yep. Jamie has presented a workshop on social, emotional, behavioral challenges. I presented a workshop on 504s versus IEPs. There's Donna is going to be also presenting a workshop on social emotional learning.
Right.
And later this year, I'm going to be talking about, I think the title of the topic is The Anatomy of an IEP. So we're really trying to.
The CPAC meets monthly,
yes.
And we post those on our Facebook page, and that information goes out. Anybody's welcome, correct?
Absolutely.
And they're virtual meetings.
They're virtual meetings. So we're really trying to work together, and we have been working together to help inform parents, understand what their needs are, what their questions are.
I think everybody's frustrated too. It's that
absolutely.
I can't say post-pandemic because we're not there yet, but this pandemic has been. trying for everyone.
And, you know, I think for the special education department is we're always striving, and so far we've accomplished it, and I'm confident we will still accomplish providing the services that our students need.
Right.
Are there bumps in the road? Absolutely. But overall, are services being delivered? Yes. And I'm grateful to be able to say that.
Excellent. So. All right. Darlene, Carrie, Jamie, you want to jump in? What do we want to see by the end of our school year?
Well, for me, what I've been really working hard on, because we do out-of-district meetings as well, I'm proud to say I'm bringing back my fourth student back to the Westville Public Schools from out-of-district placement.
She's been doing amazing work.
That is awesome news.
Yeah, we've been finding that we're able to provide these services to the students here in our school system. So,
and keep them in their community. Older, yeah,
yes. Nice. So with them being older, we're able to make those transitions. We just had one start today. And we do it in small increments, you know, putting them in a smaller classroom and then having them make that transition and then giving them more opportunities to be a part of their community.
Right.
But it's been working, and I'm happy that we're able to do that.
Thank you. And of course, we'd rather them be in our Westfield schools. Absolutely. Because they're with their friends, they're with their neighbors, their community members can participate in Westfield events. It's just, it can be a more meaningful experience for students.
One of the things to follow up on what Darlene was saying, and she's done great work with that, is this year, rather than having an evaluation team leader, although they do great work, work with the out-of-district schools, myself and the supervisor are actually the liaisons.
Okay.
So I feel that there's been more continuity that way in the opportunities for kids coming back because Darlene knows the programs in the schools.
Right.
And if it's a high school level student at the out-of-district, she'd be able to do that, Carrie at the middle and so on. And Jamie has been stepping in for some of the kids who are more in the schools for behavior.
Right.
So I think that's really helped and kept our connection and our communication mm-hmm. with the out-of-district schools as well. And,
which is important.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Carrie, what do you like to see what are we working toward for Westfield Intermediate and Westfield Middle School?
Well, Jamie and I are working together for the RISE program so that they're...
Our RISE program is our behavioral program, right, for people who need to... Okay, for
right.
our listeners.
Yes. Yeah. So we just had on the last PD day, we met with the elementary and the middle school and the intermediate school RISE teachers about making it like more cohesive throughout elementary and middle school level. And we're trying to develop protocols with that too. So that we're all on the same page and that we have very similar, like the way we talk to the students, the way that we interact with them, just so that it's a smoother transition going up. So
absolutely. From level to level.
Right.
And school to school. All right. Jamie, what are we working on? What do we want to see our outcomes for the end of the school year?
Yeah, you know, so bigger picture, like Carrie was talking about, really developing more linear programming and consistency from, like you said, level to level. You know, the big goal is really to make sure that we fill the gaps with the staffing and get some consistency in the ASD program and really just look at how we can connect each one of these schools and protocols. The understanding, I think, too, of roles of behaviorists and adjustment counselors. So Susan and I are working with Donna about, you know, really developing protocols mm-hmm. around that and with the PBIS team. So I think we have a lot of good projects that are going to strengthen, you know, the system that's in place for the public schools.
And you know what I like is that it's interesting. I think we are striving as a district to continually improve. And I think that's an important philosophy that we share as a district. We never, you know, you certainly set expectations, but even when you get there, there's always room for improvement, which is why we don't have a school improvement plan or a district improvement plan anymore. We have strategies for continuous improvement because
right.
we can always do better, and we acknowledge that.
And we work as a team. So I think that is something that has developed where
absolutely.
Behavior... as a part of social emotional learning is not a special education issue or a curriculum and instruction issue. It's both and all and extends across everything we do. So we have everyone at the table planning for those solutions. And I think
working together. Yeah.
Is important.
I agree.
One of the things that I've been grateful for is since I've been in this position, that Susan and I have worked together and really brought that special ed, general ed curriculum piece together, because they're all our kids regardless. So exactly. The fact that we communicate and kind of work on all these processes and these communications and these strategies together, I think
absolutely.
Is absolutely.
And we're vested
essential.
In the success of every child, and that's what we try to do.
I also just wanted to give a shout out to Jen Smitty. She's not here today, but she is the elementary level and pre-K level special education supervisor. And she has been instrumental in helping with student placements, IEP meetings, and just kind of juggling all the balls that are up in the air at the elementary level.
And juggling is a good word, because is she also Westfield Virtual School?
Yes.
So she works across seven schools, with Fort Meadow.
Virtual. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And the virtual.
We have a great special education team here.
We do. We really do.
All right, Pete, we're going to do one more song here, and then when we come back from the break, we're going to try to decide what year this is from. These are from.
Okay.
Traveling in a freighter combi on a hippie trailhead full of zombies. I met a strange lady, she made me nervous. She took me in and gave me breakfast. And she said, do you come from a land down under? A women glow and men blunder. Can't you hear the thunder? You better run, you better take cover.
Hey, we're back. Welcome back to Superintendent Spotlight. So that was a song, Down Under by Men at Work. So if I were to play the last song, which is what Pete's going to play hopefully when we're on our way out, is Sweet Dreams by the Eurythmics.
Yes.
Excellent music choices today, Superintendent Zaprowski. Yes.
Thank you. I'm telling you, it's.
I think I'm going to go with 83.
I'm moving back down to 82 and staying.
Okay. And remember, everybody's a winner here on Superintendent Spotlight. Okay. So. Deb?
84.
84.
Do we have guesses from our guests?
I'm going to go with 82.
Jamie. Okay. Jamie is 82. Darlene, any guesses?
I'm going to go with 83.
Okay. Carrie?
83.
And the answer is 83. Oh. 1983.
Woo-hoo.
So
sorry.
Nice
job. You're all in the right wheelhouse,
nice
though.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure if that, I think one thing this proves that we're all old. Because
yeah, we
remember
all
this.
Pretty close.
But what's interesting is our kids will know none of that music, probably, right? Although Weezer came out with a new version of Africa. Like,
which I thought was pretty good.
Ago. I did too. It sounded kind of like just like Toto, though, I thought.
But our kids know updated, it, yeah. But they say they like the oldies, and that's
these are the oldies.
What they're talking.
The oldies. Yeah, these are the oldies. How does that make you feel?
Classic rock.
Or yes. Yeah,
classic rock.
The 90s are now classic rock. Yes. I heard that the other day. I'm like, oh my God. We're getting old. All right. We're approaching the end of the show, and I want to thank everybody for being our guest today. Any last minute thoughts you want to share just about our work moving forward, our work that we've done, your very positive experience on Superintendent Spotlight, anything like that?
I just want to thank the parents for their understanding,
yes,
and their trust,
absolutely.
Because it absolutely means a lot. So,
absolutely. Anyone, Darlene?
No, I just think we've been doing a really great job in filling in the gaps, doing the best that we can.
Absolutely.
I think the opportunity to do remote meetings have given us a higher percentage of having meetings done. So
agreed.
Hopefully we can continue in that direction.
Absolutely. All right, Carrie, closing thoughts?
No, I agree. And I just also that with the PLCs that I'm running, I'm also working very hard with the staff about accommodations. And that's like our plan for this year is to really work on those and to get them into the general education setting clearer and better for everyone. So
that's great.
Perfect. Jamie?
Yeah, I applaud everybody that wakes up every day, shows up, and puts the amount of effort that everyone is doing and just getting these things done and moving forward. And the positivity that I see with teachers, administrators every single day in relation to, you know, today's a new day, let's go out there and get it. So I think that, you know, that just shows that drive that everyone wants to strive to get better and continue to do the best thing that we can for the kids.
Absolutely. And make no mistake about it, for teachers and educators across the country, this is probably one of the most challenging school years we've ever had. And so, and our teachers are working incredible, and our administrators, just our staff in general, are working very hard, and we couldn't do this without them. So we appreciate, I know teacher appreciation isn't until May, but we can
right.
do some
but
appreciation right now.
So we can show our gratitude
for that.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
To our educators. Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you all for joining us.
Thank you, guys.
And thank you for playing our song game. All right.
Thank you. Goodbye.
So next week we are not on the air because it is Thanksgiving and there is no school. There's also no school Wednesday next week. Right?
By the way, you're invited to a taping on Tuesday afternoon at 2:00 if you want to drop by and be on Thanksgiving Day.
Okay.
Bobby G and Company is going to do a 4-hour taping.
Oh, wow. Good for Bobby
Thanksgiving.
G.
Yeah.
All right. Nice.
So you can pop in if you want.
All right. But we are on December 2nd again, and we have Principal Chuck Jendrzejczyk from Westfield High School in the first half hour. And then we haven't had Principal Tom Osborne on since September. So we're going to get a virtual school update.
That's great.
So he'll be on for the second half hour. And that's our next show. So, folks, have a great weekend. Happy Thanksgiving. And we'll catch you in 2 weeks. Thank you.
Day.